We're going to read out of the Gospel of Matthew today, chapter 10, verses 40 through 42. The sermon of the scripture is a little different. Oh, I didn't give it one. So it's not the one that you have, though. So still the same scripture. But if you listen to the sermon, you're like, what does that have to do with the sermon title? Probably not a whole lot. But here we go, with Matthew chapter 10, verses 40 through 42. Jesus tells his disciples, "Whoever welcomes you welcomes me, and whoever welcomes me welcomes the one who sent me. Whoever welcomes a prophet in the name of a prophet will receive a prophet's reward, and whoever welcomes a righteous person in the name of a righteous person will receive the reward of the righteous. And whoever gives even a cup of cold water to one of these little ones in the name of a disciple, truly, I tell you, none of these will lose their reward." This past week, I had to rent a 12x6 U-Haul trailer and head out of town to go pick up some stuff. It's been a while since I actually hauled anything, but I got my little Dodge Dakota truck with a hitch and hooked up that 12x6 trailer and just prayed to God that I didn't have to do a lot of backing up. But I'm okay driving with a trailer. I can do it. It just doesn't always look all that smooth. But I had to get out on the highway. It was an out-of-town trip. And as I started to leave town out towards Fort Madison, I'm in the left lane, and all of a sudden, the big semi just slams on its brakes, and I'm forced to, you know, all at the same time, just look in my mirror, figure out if I can take a right or if I just need to slam the brakes on too. Well, my little Dodge Dakota mirrors, you know, they go out about this far. I mean, it's not very far, but I can see in the right lane a little bit. I can see that there is a car back behind me. I'm not exactly sure how far behind me, but it looks like I have enough room to make it in there, and so I turn my turn signal on, and I merge into the right lane and quickly pass by the truck that slammed on its brakes so conveniently, and I think everything is fine. Well, that car that I saw in my mirror, apparently they got behind me and they quickly passed that truck, and then they got into the left lane because they wanted to communicate some things to me. And as I look to my left, I'm thinking, oh, there's somebody passing me, but their mouths are going like this, just very quickly, as if I could hear something, but they seem to be straining themselves to speak loud enough that I can hear, but I really can't. And the other thing that was interesting was the facial expressions, as if they were very, very unhappy about something. I can't hear them, so I have no idea what it could possibly be. And they were both looking at me as opposed to the road in front of them, which is a little disturbing for the person driving. They didn't seem worried about the road in front of them at all, but they were very, very focused on me. They were also very good at sign language. Very good at sign language. They're a very talented couple. And I don't know a lot of sign language, but I did know the ones that they were using to communicate with me. And then finally they started to go ahead, and I thought, whew, those people just, you know, that's too much drama for just being on the road. And then all of a sudden, I saw a 48-ounce cup of liquid fly towards the truck, and I'm going to tell you, that's the first time that's ever happened to me, but I'm going to go out on a limb and say that wasn't the first time this young lady threw those giant drinks out her window, because she nailed right in the middle of my windshield. I couldn't do that if it depended on my life, but this young lady, she was like an expert at this, because bam, all over my window, and all I could think was, wow, What a great way to start a trip with a nice, cool, refreshing soft drink. But I got to thinking, I wonder who those people are. I have no clue who they are, but I wonder who they represent. You know, who are their parents? Where do they work? They probably work somewhere. Do they go to church? Because if they go to church, that would not reflect well upon the church that they go to. I wonder who those folks represent. Because the way they behaved wouldn't be a very good reflection on anyone. But it got me thinking how we do represent someone. We represent someone or we represent some group all of the time. That is a truth that we can't get around. We're connected in ways that, whether we want to admit it or not, we're connected in ways that what our actions and what our words say and do reflect on someone or another group. Jesus understands this, and he begins to teach his disciples about this central truth, that we represent him. He's very clear with his words. He says, "Whoever receives you receives me, and whoever receives me receives God, who is the one who sent me." So in essence, we are representatives of God. We are Jesus' presence here on earth. When people look to the church, when they see what we do, when they see how we go about doing it, when they check our attitudes, it is all a reflection on Christ. If we're against a bunch of things, it reflects on Christ. If we're for a bunch of things, it reflects on Christ. Everything that we do is a reflection of Jesus Christ. So we are Christ's representatives on earth. When we walk into the church, we represent Christ. Sometimes there's a temptation to see ourselves as customers and to evaluate church on how well things appeal to us. But instead, Christ says, no, no, no. You're my representative. So when we walk into church, we ought to evaluate church and judge church based on how well are we being representatives of Christ and Christ's mission of helping people find their way to God. So churches ought to be judged on how well are we creating places of grace and mercy and forgiveness that allow people to embrace and experience the presence of the Holy One. We are representatives of Christ. This Sunday is a little bit sentimental for me. Those of you that know me know that my mother is a minister, is a Christian Church Disciples of Christ minister in Lomax, Illinois. Lomax is just a few miles past Dallas City, Illinois, but my mom's been there for 8 years. And after 8 years, this Sunday is her very last Sunday at the church. She's semi-retired. Now, I say semi-retired because even though she doesn't have another church to go to, I just know that my mother will not be retired. I know that there's plenty for her to be doing, and I have no idea what's next. But as I began to reflect on what it means to represent Christ and be his representative, I got thinking, I don't know anybody that's better at representing Christ than my mother. Because it was my mother that represented Christ through an awkward and sometimes miserable and painful blended family for about the last 35 years. Anybody relate to that? Somehow, throughout all that, it ended up being a pretty good family for being a blended family. But there were some rough spots. But my mom represented Christ in a loving, caring way through all of it. My mom represented Christ through getting two teenage sons through high school. You know, that's not an easy job at all. But she did do that. She represented Christ when she helped two sons get through some painful marital experiences. Another thing that's not a small thing, she represented Christ when she came down with breast cancer a few years ago. And fortunately, the church rallied around her, and they loved on her and cared for her, and she was able to go through treatments, and she got through it. And she represented Christ and God's presence in her life through all of that. She represented Christ in a community there at that church that suffered through a lot. If you've ever heard of the movie Aaron Brockovich, that basically is Lomax, Illinois. There were water lines that went through the city that were contaminated with oil. And because of that, they fixed it 4 years ago, but because of that, 75% of Lomax people end up getting cancer. And so she, in 8 years, has ministered and given pastoral care to close to between 40 and 50 people who have come down with cancer, which is no small thing when you've dealt with the mortality of breast cancer yourself. I have to say that I'm pretty proud of my mom. I'm pretty proud that she represented Christ so well. Is it okay for a son to brag and be proud? But I'm proud of her because that small community had a big-time leader. A big-time leader that loved Jesus with all of her heart. And I will tell you as her son that she always lived what she preached with all of her heart. She always lived and what she preached with all of her being. I had an interesting conversation with my mom as she, a few weeks ago, actually on Mother's Day, we began talking about this day that was coming ahead, and she was torn. She was excited that she was going to be able, she was retiring because of health issues, because of stresses and demands and different things, and so it wasn't like she was like dying to get out of the church. She was doing it as a means to an end. But she began to share with me, she said, well, you know, I'm excited that I'll be able to do these other things, but she said, I'm really not excited that I'm leaving the church so that I can come to this. And basically pointing at the house of, you know, you're getting ready to move, doing sorting and packing. I know this sounds like a blast, but that can actually be overwhelming. But also referencing ambiguously to the demands of a domestic life. And I said, Mom, I said, I want you to know, you're not leaving the church so that you can come to this. God just hasn't shown you yet what you're leaving the church to go to. I said, God's not done with you. God still has plans for you. God just hasn't quite shown you yet what those plans are. And I got to thinking, that's really what a representative of Jesus is all about. There comes a time where we just have to say, God, I don't have all the answers. God, I don't know what the next step really is. And we come to those points, whether we're new Christians or whether we've been Christians our entire lives, but there's nothing wrong with saying, God, I don't know. God, I don't know, but I'm going to keep my eyes on you and wait. Wait for you to show me my next step so that I can embrace the future that you have for me with all of my heart and with all of my soul. That's what representatives of Christ do. You know, sometimes we go into church committees and we think that we have to have all the answers, but we don't. Sometimes we look at marriages or relationships with children or our health and we feel like we have to have all the answers. And even worse, sometimes we look at God and we think we have to understand everything. But the truth is, as representatives of Christ, we need not have all the answers, but we do need to be willing to say, God, I don't know, but I'm looking, I'm waiting, and I'm longing for you to show me. That's what it means to represent Christ, and the world will take note. One more thing I want to share with you about my mom's story. There's something that all ministers don't like. There's one thing, probably just one thing, that's it, that ministers don't like, and at some point in our careers, we will whine and complain like little babies about it. But it's something that my mom excelled at greatly. What we don't like, well, let me just tell you about my mom's story here. When she went to the post office in Lomax, Illinois, guess who she was? Joel, I bet you know.
She was the minister.
She was Pastor Peggy. That's right. When she went to the Pink Tavern with my dad and they had burgers for lunch or supper, or probably both lunch and supper because they were really good burgers, guess who she was? She was Pastor Peggy. When she went to the senior center and she led Bible study, guess who she was? She was Pastor Peggy. When they had a community worship service at the park, she was Pastor Peggy. When they had a parade and the church had her involved, she was Pastor Peggy to the community. Wherever she went, she was Pastor Peggy, and people smiled and they welcomed her and they liked her because they knew with Pastor Peggy that there was somebody that they could see God's presence in, whether they knew God or not. They could tell there was something different about her, and that she welcomed them and brought goodness and blessings to their lives. And that's why for 8 years, for Lomax, Illinois, they had Pastor Peggy. Folks, we don't get to take a break from being representatives of Christ. It's not like we walk into church and we're representatives of Christ, but when we go home or we go somewhere else, we get to take a break. If we call ourselves followers of Jesus, and if we love him and serve him, we embrace the role that he has given to us as his representatives to a world that needs to know God. And will know God through relationship with you and with me. So we are representatives of Christ. So may today we commit to letting those wonderful words of life that came from Jesus' lips to his disciples, may they be etched in our hearts and soul. And may we embrace them with all of our being when Jesus said, "Whoever receives you receives me. And whoever receives me receives the one who sent me. I guess we've been sent. Amen.